been 28 years since the introduction of 2G GSM cellular service. We're almost going on 30 years. What's the current state of it right now? Well, there is only one network left that even supports these phones. Now, you may remember a couple years ago, I made a video that I was still using a Nokia, and I've used a smartphone in between, but I always go back to a dumb phone because the distractions of modern cellular phones or smartphones just gets to be too much. It's a hassle, and on top of that, it really distracts you. And I really like the simpler nature of a phone that is a phone. You know the saying, do one thing and do it well. And nothing quite beats the Nokia phone. Well, what is the state of 2G? Well, like I said, there's only one cellular carrier left that even supports a 2G phone like this, and it's T-Mobile. Now, in my case, I'm using Metro PCS, but that runs on the T-Mobile network, which means other carriers that are based on the T-Mobile network, like Mint Mobile, probably will work on this as well. However, I have to stress this. The days are numbered, people. T-Mobile plans to finally phase out 2G GSM service at the 30-year mark or the 29-year mark, basically next year. But they say through 2020, which means it could be in 2020. It might be 2021. We're not entirely certain. T-Mobile really doesn't know. And the only reason for that is some people are still using these, like me. Now, how is the service still working? Well, that's what's interesting. T-Mobile kept the service alive by letting this phone share the spectrum with LTE. So this phone runs on 1900 megahertz, which is what T-Mobile uses for 2G and LTE. And I think they were supporting 3G in there as well. But basically, T-Mobile plans to shut down 3G before they shut down 2G. Now, it's very odd when you think about that, considering AT&T did away with it all. So what exactly is T-Mobile doing, and why are they keeping 2G longer than 3G? Well, because of how these phones work, it can live on the guard band of LTE, which is a tiny, tiny little sliver, and it still works. You see how quick this phone boots up and gets a signal and has service ready to go. It gets phone calls, it gets text messages, and the phone calls are ridiculously clear. In fact, I thought it was kind of surprising because when I called a friend, she said, "Wow, you're loud and clear. Did you change phones?" And I was like, "Why, yes. I went to a phone that's 20 years old, and I was louder and clearer than I was on a smartphone." And that's with only a fraction of the 2G service even being used. So these phones were very, very efficient. But like I said, the days are numbered. And it's unfortunate because they don't make phones quite like this anymore. You know, I get asked all the time when people see my phone, they're like, "Are you for real? Is this thing even working?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I get good service on it still." Now, I gotta be very specific with that, though. When I say I get good service with this, I get good service where 2G was already in effect. Meaning, no new towers are being built with 2G and haven't been for a while. So this phone's connecting to a tower that already had 2G service, which I think they were still putting them up around 10 years ago. So, for example, in my home, I got full coverage, 4 out of 4 bars, you know. However, when I go to the Home Depot, that's one city over, I get nothing at all. In fact, though, what's interesting is my smartphone would get 2 bars. So it's a bit of a trade-off. So sure, you are getting less coverage with this, but this wasn't getting much better either. Sure, this could make a phone call when this one didn't see service at all. But what was interesting is the Metro PCS logo was still there, which means technically it had something. You see, on these Nokias, if it totally loses signal, the carrier name will disappear. But the carrier name remains. So the phone, even though it showed no bars, it still had something to lock on to. Which isn't the same for this, because when I'm on the highway, this phone will just flat out go to no service quite often. Now, it doesn't matter if I have this on 3G or LTE. I get the same signal quality between the two. Sometimes I get LTE better than I get 3G, but because this is a bring-your-own-phone with my network, I tend to not be able to use LTE, voiceover LTE. So my phone calls don't go through LTE. Text messages do, which is interesting, but no voiceover LTE with this. And since I can't do that anyway, I might as well just go back to this, because that means then this phone would get shut down for voice calls before this even does. That's very confusing when you think about it, especially since 3G is going to be shut down first before 2G on the T-Mobile network. So in effect, unless T-Mobile allows any phone actually capable of voiceover LTE using their methods or protocols, or I don't know the specifics of voiceover LTE, but technically this phone is compatible with the T-Mobile network. However, because it's not one that they've certified, it's not whitelisted. You see, with GSM phones, as long as the phone sees the network, is compatible with that frequency, and can read the SIM card, and we'll get back to that in a second, then the phone just works. With voiceover LTE, the carrier has to whitelist your phone. They generally only do that with their own phones, iPhones being an exception because the same phone is used among different carriers, basically. There's a very little internal thing on how that works. People got paid, this and that. It's a long story. But back to SIM cards. You see, if I shut down my phone and open up my battery compartment, if I can, there we go, you will find that my phone's SIM card is a nano SD in a bunch of different adapters just to get it to work. Well, that's once again unfortunate because basically, simply put, this phone, It's getting harder to get SIM cards for it. So I'll go ahead and turn it on, and it's booting right back up. And I got service. That's how quick it is to turn on. Whereas a smartphone takes quite a while to turn on. There is a caveat to this, though, and I discovered this on accident. Not all SIM cards, modern SIM cards, will work with this. Most do, but I have found that some SIM cards simply don't have the data necessary for a 2G phone to operate, in which case this will either say insert SIM or it'll try to do something but lock up. What was interesting is this SIM card that's in here right now, even though it works on this phone, would not actually work in a Motorola Razr. It would lock up that phone. Very interesting. And now, with all the scares of SIM jacking, I thought it was interesting to try SIM jacking this phone. Well, that had a very interesting effect, whereas, as far as I understand, my carrier is not you can't SIM jack my particular carrier because the SIM card doesn't run the same operating system that the whole SIM jacking thing relies on. But when I tried to SIM jack it with this phone, nothing happened. The phone just continued to operate and everything was good as normal. When I tried to SIM jack this phone, the phone switched to insert SIM card. Thought that was a very interesting effect. So even though it's kind of immune, this phone takes attacks a little bit differently. But I'm kind of curious though. Is that a security feature? Does the phone detect that something is trying to access it and it just disconnects the SIM card electronically and says, hey, look, I don't see that SIM card anymore. You might want to check that out. Or did it just crash the SIM card and the phone's like, oh, I don't know what just happened. Anyway, I thought this was very interesting because technology, you know, advances at a very rapid rate. And we're now going into 5G service, which as far as I understand is really currently kind of an enhanced LTE. It's not so much as a 5th or 5th generation service, kind of like AT&T's whole 4G when it was really just 3.5G. So this is more like LTE and a half or something like that. I don't know the specifics and I'm sure I'll be corrected because pedantic YouTube generally will do that. You're wrong no matter what. Sky's blue. No, you're not. No, it's not. It's green. Well, this phone is candy apple cherry red. It's still used every day. In fact, when I was hospitalized in 2017, this was the only phone that actually was giving me service in my hospital room, whereas a smartphone got nothing at all. So, you know, like I said, a little bit of service, no service, or service, no service. Take your pick. It's touch and go, really. But the thing you have to remember, if you really want a 2G cell phone to be used in 2019, just expect that you're probably going to be disappointed in the next couple years because, like I said, T-Mobile's network is the last even supporting second generation cellular networks. In fact, as much as I don't like T-Mobile, they sure have been very versatile in the networks they support. Whereas AT&T and all these other carriers are very quick to shut off deprecated cellular networks, T-Mobile has held on this whole time. And the funny thing is, this phone didn't need to be unlocked to be used on T-Mobile. And the reason for that, this used to be a VoiceStream phone. Now, I did unlock it anyway just because I wanted that freedom, but it didn't have to be. Because this phone was a VoiceStream phone, when T-Mobile bought out VoiceStream in America, this would have continued working anyway. In fact, if you think about it, when this phone was new, cellular phones were so expensive, you almost didn't make phone calls on these unless it was an emergency. Which is why, even though people seem to think that these phones have a battery life that will last you a month, that's not actually true at all. These phones' talk time is at most 3 hours. That's not a lot, actually. Standby, however, is like anywhere between 20 to 80 hours. It's yeah, it could last you a week on standby, but phone calls, not so much. These phones did use a lot of energy to actually make phone calls. So remember, these were kind of more for emergency use, or if you were rich and a businessman and you had to have that phone on the go, these are what you had back then. These didn't become more popular until later. Now, the Nokia 5190 was one, the 5100 series, I believe, is the one that introduced the Express-On colors. You could change the faceplate. This phone does not look like a 5190 anymore because it's had the faceplate changed with one, I think, that was actually made for a 5125. but the rest of the phone's the same, so the faceplates actually are interchangeable. In fact, I still have the original faceplate that came with this phone, which was this, and the one when I was in high school. And yes, this one has a phone attached to it still. I actually have two 5190s. You see, these phones were originally owned by my parents. My mother had one and my father had one, and both had the black faceplate. Neither one of them ever changed the faceplates on them. And of course, when I was in school, you know, you had to have these faceplates. You had to have all the cool things. Everything was just, you had to do it. You had to be so unique. Of course, by the time I got out of high school, though, this was already obsolete, actually. 2G phones were still a thing at that time. I think 3G might have been around. No, actually, Edge was. I believe Edge came out. Which people in error seem to think that Edge is 2.5G. That's actually not the case. I think 2.5G is GPRS, and Edge was like a 2.75. It's kind of funny. I could be wrong on that as well. I didn't really research it just because this is more of an ad-libbed video. But yeah, you know, take it or leave it. These phones are awesome. I've never thought a cell phone would last 20 years of abuse. You know, I had this phone when I was working for the county, and I was up on a ladder and I fell above a portable building. The phone fell out of my pocket. Didn't even crack. Smartphone or an iPhone 4S falls from table height to the floor. Crack screen. Go figure. Anyway, YouTube, I hope this video was kind of entertaining and a little bit educational. But even though I'm using a 2G phone, I don't recommend you go out and actually get one. The days on these things are numbered. I'm just going to use it until the service finally gets shut off, and then I have to get another one. And there is actually a Verizon phone I'm very much interested in that's also a dumb phone, but kind of like military quality, and it's a little bit on the pricey side, but if I have to switch phones, it's going to be that one because it does support LTE, and it would probably last yet another 20 years, and that's how I buy phones. I buy phones only when required. So when I buy a phone, smartphones are not an option because these don't last more than a few years. They don't get updates. They end up being useless for even apps. And honestly, when I'm outside, I don't want apps. I don't want Facebook. I don't want Messenger. All I want is text messaging and phone service. That's it. And that's what I got with this. Have a good one, YouTube.